International Standard Atmosphere. What it is, why do we have it, and how do we use it in everyday operations? Let's jump right into it. Hi there, I'm Gabriele from paroclimb.com. I'm a Boeing 737 trainer captain, and today with you I want to share what you have to know about the International Standard Atmosphere. Before starting, if you have any question regarding any topic you would like to discuss and you want me to make a video about that, just leave me a comment below and then I will consider your request. Also, if you want to support the channel, please consider subscribing and give it a like to the video. Alright, so let's jump into the International Standard Atmosphere. By the end of this video, you will know exactly what it is, why do we have it in the aviation world, and how do we use it during everyday operations. So before starting talking about the characteristic of the International Standard Atmosphere, we need to understand one concept. So let's look at the whiteboard. Okay, let's imagine, for example, that you have your aircraft. So I'm gonna draw yourself in here in the airport over the mean sea level pretty much, okay? So that's you with your aircraft here, ready for takeoff, okay? And then I draw myself here in another airport at the mean sea level. Here we go, that's me, okay? In my aircraft, above the mean sea level, okay? So what we can see from the picture, even if the drawing is not perfect, and I know that, but we can see that these two aircraft, they are basically in the same position, because those aircraft are over a runway that are pretty much over the mean sea level. So what happened is that if you have got your aircraft above the mean sea level, in an airport above mean sea level, and I've got my aircraft above mean sea level, if the atmospheric conditions are the same, then the performance of our aircraft will be exactly the same. Fantastic. The problem is, I live in south of Europe and maybe you live in north of Europe, so the conditions at your airport, even though it's at the same elevation of my airport, are completely different. So let's say you live in Norway and your airport above the mean sea level has got a temperature of 0 degrees Celsius, all right? And I live in Canaries, where my airport above the mean sea level has got a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius. So even though we've got the same physical situation, because the airport is at the same elevation, both airports are at the same elevations, what we've got is a different temperature. Completely different temperature. So as you can see, these two aircraft, your aircraft and my aircraft, will act in a very different way. So if we have got a limited runway, for example, the airports are the same, the length of the airport are the same, okay? And if it's limited, what will happen is that maybe you will be able to take off and I won't be able to take off. So because of this, even though the physical characteristic of the airport and the airplane are the same, the atmospheric conditions are completely different. So what the ICAO established in the 50s was the ISA, the International Standard Atmosphere, not that everybody uses a reference. It's like the same as talking about the time, okay? For me now is around 10 o'clock a.m. Maybe for you it's 7 p.m. The problem is that we've got different time depending on the places. The same applies to the atmospheric conditions. So we need a reference that we can base our performance on. So what the ICAO said, okay, they said, let's make a standard atmosphere. Okay, so they basically create the standard atmosphere. Then in your airport, when you are taking off, you take your temperature, in this case 0 degrees, and you check compared to the standard atmosphere where your daily conditions are. So everybody can actually use the reference and then apply the performance of your aircraft using a deviation from the standard atmosphere. Okay, now that this topic is clear, let's jump into the characteristic of the International Standard Atmosphere. The characteristic of the International Standard Atmosphere made by the ICAO in the 50s are the following. The ICAO said that the temperature in the ISA conditions at the mean sea level is 15 degrees Celsius. The QNH, or the pressure at the mean sea level, I made a separate video about this, go and check that out if you don't know what the QNH is, it's equal to 1013.25 hectopascal. This is equal to 29.92 inches of Mercury. Okay, so we've got a temperature of 50 degrees and a pressure at the mean sea level of 1013.25 hectopascal. Everybody knows that with the altitude, the pressure and the temperature decreases. So the ICAO said that with the altitude, we have a pressure and a temperature decreasement of 1.98 degrees Celsius per 1,000 feet, which we can call it 2 degrees Celsius per 1,000 feet, okay? And then a decrease in pressure of 1 hectopascal each 27 feet, that we can call it 30 feet, just to make it easier, okay? So this is how the temperature and the pressure decreases with the increasement of the altitude. Fantastic. So now we know that, for example, at the mean sea level, we've got 15 degrees. What will happen is that at 1,000 feet, our ISA temperature will be around 13 degrees, okay? At 2,000 feet will be 2 degrees colder, and so on. So we can actually figure it out which temperature, according to the International Standard Atmosphere, we could have at 20,000 feet, all right? How do we do that? In order to calculate the temperature at 20,000 feet in this case, okay, we have to think in this way. We know that by the ICAO standard atmosphere, the temperature at the mean sea level is 15 degrees, and we also know that every 1,000 feet, the pressure decreases by 2 degrees Celsius. So after 10,000 feet, let's make it in here, at 10,000 feet, the temperature has decreased by 20 degrees, because if it decreases 2 degrees every 1,000 feet, 10,000 feet, the temperature will be decreased by minus 20 degrees. So if we start here at 50 degrees Celsius, minus 20, the temperature at 10,000 feet will be minus 5 degrees. All right, so at 20,000 feet, however, we're gonna have another minus 20 degrees decreasement, because at 11,000 feet, the temperature will be minus 7. At 12,000 feet, the temperature will be minus 9, and so on. And at 20,000 feet, the temperature will be minus 25 degrees Celsius. All right, so this is according to the standard atmosphere, to the ICAO standard atmosphere, also called International Standard Atmosphere. The same applies to the pressure, because if we know that for each 30 feet we've got 1 hectopascal of difference, if we know the pressure at the mean sea level, we only have to calculate what's the difference between the mean sea level and your target altitude, and we calculate what pressure we could have at 20,000 feet. Fantastic. This is the ISA, the ICAO standard atmosphere, but what is the difference between the reality? Let's make an example. In reality, let's say we are here, the airport is over the mean sea level, and in today we've got a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius over the mean sea level, okay? So that means that this airport in this day has got a temperature that is warmer than the standard temperature, than the AESA temperature, of 5 degrees warmer. So we can also say that the airport in this day has got a temperature of ISA plus 5, because the ISA temperature is 15 degrees at the mean sea level, and this day the mean sea level temperature is 20, so has got a temperature of ISA plus 5. And this is very important to understand and know, because then you have to go into your aircraft, take the performance table, and check in that day your ISA deviation. The ISA deviation is something that we use every day, because depending on your ISA deviation, your performance will change a lot. Well, let's make another example here. When the temperature at your airport that is located on the mean sea level is, for example, minus 5 degrees, all right? So in this case, minus 5 degrees is a temperature that is colder than 15 degrees, is colder than the 15 degrees. It's colder by 20 degrees. So what will happen? We can also say that the temperature in our airport that is located at mean sea level is ISA minus 20 degrees, because the standard temperature on the mean sea level is 15, and our real temperature day on the airport is -5, so there is a deviation of 20 degrees. Fantastic. The same also apply when we are talking about the pressure, because the ICAO International Standard Atmosphere, as we discussed already, said that there is a the QNH is 1013.25 hectopascal, and that the pressure decreases with the increment of the altitude by 1 hectopascal each 30 feet, okay, approximately. Fantastic. So what will happen is that if we have we are in AESA conditions, that means that our aircraft has got a standard performance and everything is fine. But what happens when that day, because the pressure changes every day, even during the day in the same location, okay? So the pressure you've got at your place is different than the pressure that you had yesterday. So let's say that today we have a very low pressure situation. So instead of having the 1013 hectopascal, let's say you've got, this is the sea level and this is your airport in real conditions. Let's say that the pressure at the mean sea level is 1000 hectopascal. So you've got a lower pressure, and this will for sure make your performance of your aircraft worsen. So what will happen is that in real life, you have to calculate the difference between the 1013, the 1000 feet, and then adapt your performance in order to make sure that you are able to take off. Because if you keep your eyes at the eyes, as conditions always, one day you will need a longer runway to take off. Because let's think about here. So the 1013 is here. Since we've got 1000 hectopascal that day, for real life, is like taking off at an airport that is higher than the AESA airports. Okay, so if we do the comparison and we take the deviation from the real life to compared to this AESA, in the airport is still there, but in real life, the aircraft thinks that you are actually taking off from an airport that is above your airport, because the pressure is low, and since the pressure decreases with the altitude, the airplane performance will be the same as an aircraft departing from an higher airport. This is very important to understand when we're talking about the International Standard Atmosphere. So now we know what the International Standard Atmosphere is, why we have got, and what the AESA deviation is. Many aircraft, many sophisticated aircraft nowadays calculate the AESA deviation automatically, and they automatically adapt the performance for the AESA deviation. But you need to constantly know your pressure and temperature different compared to your International Standard Atmosphere. Okie dokie. So, I hope this video was clear for you. If you have any question regarding the video, just leave me a comment below. Also, like the video if you want to support the channel, and go to paroclimb.com where you can subscribe for free paro training content. And I'll see you in the next one.